So yeah, after lunch, my favorite spot, everybody are in food coma. But yeah, Mark already did some of the shaking for me, so I'll take it from there. Okay, we're going to talk about DevOps. And we are going to figure out, together with you, whether DevOps is something good for developers or maybe not. First of all, how many of you think they know what DevOps is? Well, yeah, okay, but about half, I guess. Yeah, maybe, kinda. Maybe you think you know what it is, maybe you don't. Well, it's been around for 15 years. For something that is so big in our industry and been around for so long, the fact that a lot of people are still not sure what it is astonishing. There is something there that needs to be unpacked. Why aren't we sure what the thing is? It should be that obvious by now. How many people know what LLM is? Everybody, and it's been like, what, half a year, right? And DevOps has been around for 15. All right, let's talk about that. So what are we going to do? I'm going to introduce you to a conspiracy theory. Beautiful one. I hope we will be somewhere here in like maybe living reality or you know, we are intrigued. Definitely not going to this area for sure. Yeah, let's see what's going on. So, yeah, conspiracy theory. Hear me out. DevOps is an elaborate plot by the ops people to make us, the developers, work harder. Right? Now, I have proof, which is coming. Okay, so my name is Baruch Sadogursky. I'm at JBaruch everywhere on whatever social media is called this week. Developer productivity advocate with a great company called Gradle. You might be familiar with Gradle as a Gradle build tool, which is, if I remember correctly, to be very nitpicking, is the most popular build tool like in the world right now, if we don't consider package managers, build tools, or something like that. Anyway, it's great. So yeah, Gradle, check it out. I've been, the reason why I'm telling you all that about developers and DevOps and stuff, because I used to be just a software developer for a longer time, and then went to developer relations, and Marie already told you everything about it, and then we did like huge things in DevOps with the company called JFrog that you might have heard about. And now I went kind of back to engineering with developer productivity engineering and stuff. Anyway, couple of books, DevOps tools for Java developers. That's why I kind of talk to you right now. I studied everything about it, how DevOps and developers interact. And this is why the conspiracy theory. And Liquid Software about how to release software better. It made a point towards DevOps. We're going to talk about that. So the most important slide of this talk is this. If you go to speaking.jbaruch, you will find there the slides. They're already there. The video that I'm shooting right now, considering that I tapped all the keys correctly, we'll see. And all the links for everything, starting with the chart of conspiracy theories that for some reason still doesn't have my conspiracy theory in it, but we're working on it, and many others, and all the links for everything we're going to talk about. To make it easy to remember, it's in the bottom of every slide, right here, speaking.jbaruch, together with the Twitter handle of this conference. When you praise this talk, you will mention them, they will retweet, everybody wins, and a couple of hashtags and what's not. So yeah, as I mentioned, developer right here. Who, any developers? Everybody, right? Most of you, any ops people that I need to be aware of and kind of stay away? Okay, yeah, yeah, Jeremy. Yeah, well, we're gonna have a talk. Okay, so anyway, I'm a developer at like originally, and once a developer, always a developer. So I know exactly what I'm talking about. Okay. Exhibit one, the most important book about DevOps called The Phoenix Project. If you are not aware of this book, you really should take a look of it and read it, because it's amazing. It's kind of a rewrite of The Goal, which is another very, very, very important book in like engineering in general. It's kind of a rewrite of The Goal for software. And it's a novel about DevOps. Basically, there is the main protagonist that invents DevOps and wins, right, to make it very simple. Now, in order for you to understand why I think that DevOps is a plot of ops people, all we need to do is look no further than the cover of the Phoenix Project. All the main characters of the Phoenix Project are on the main cover. Let's see who's who. So we start with Patty. She's the director of IT service support. She's in ops. And then we have Ves, who's director of distributed technology, ops. He's in ops. And then there is Sarah. She's in marketing, but has ops in the title, so it's ops. And then we have Steve, who is a CEO and CTO. And then we have Dick, who is a CFO. And here is Bill Palmer. He is the protagonist who invents DevOps. And he is obviously VP of IT ops. He's obviously in ops. And then we have Eric, who is the board member. And he is the only one who read The Goal. And then he kind of read The Goal. There is all there. And then, like, ah, DevOps, and all this stuff. And then there's Brad, and he's a lead sysadmin, which is ops. And then there is John. He's in information security. He was bullied through the entire book, so he kind of hides there in the back. But yeah, OK. Anyone notice anything here? What's going on? No developers, right? The most important book about DevOps, and there are no developers. Well, there are developers through the book, and let me tell you, they are not pictured in the best of lights. Those are the lazy bastards who kind of work 9 to 5 and then drop their pen or their keyboard or whatever and just go home. Right, this is like, they're not the good guys in the story. Well, eventually they become, but they don't start like that. So yeah, there's that. They teach us. Who teaches about DevOps? Who teaches about DevOps? We can check in Google who are on the top search of Google who like teaches us about DevOps. That will be our Amazon Web Services, which is an ops platform. And it will be Atlassian, which is a very DevOps, DevOps company. And then it will be GitLab, and they sell you something that is called DevOps in a box or automated DevOps or something like that. And there will be Microsoft, which was their Azure is an ops platform. Who else? TechTarget, journalists, fine. Wikipedia, OK. Synopsys, that's an observability platform, which is very ops. And then Logs.io, another observability platform, very ops. IBM here in the bottom, they try to do a DevOps platform as well. So yeah, I mean, everybody who teaches DevOps are ops companies. So, I mean, it's pretty obvious by now. Now, the question is why? Why ops people are so obsessed with selling DevOps ideas to us? You might think, follow the money. This is what people usually do. First of all, how a Linux system administrator shift their career to DevOps? Well, Quora is obviously a great source for correct answers, as you all know. This one is particularly illuminating because that's a very good answer from DevOps online trainer with tons of years of experience. And they go like, OK, learn Linux fundamentals, which is ops, and then cloud computing, like some cloud, and then DevOps fundamentals, so read the DevOps, the Phoenix project, and then something, something, and then basically learn something that's called Gits. And basically, if you learn something that is, I mean, you're a system administrator, you learn Gits, and next thing you know, you are a DevOps engineer, which is pretty cool, I think. And the next thing you know, you go from making this amount of money to making this amount of money by becoming DevOps engineer, which is pretty sweet. And all you need to do is be Linux administrator and learn Gits. Now, next thing you know, Even now, with all the economic downturn and what's not, there are almost 20,000 open positions for DevOps engineers in the United States, which is pretty sweet considering all the layoffs and everything that's going on. And then, next thing you know, hey, let's make money out of certifications. AWS Certified DevOps Engineer, which is also a pretty good way to earn money from everybody wins, right? AWS teaches people what DevOps is, like learning Gits and stuff. And then those people make more money, and I guess everybody are happy. But the thing is, that's not the real reason. That's not the real reason, because when DevOps started and gained the momentum, obviously there wasn't like huge salaries or certification or what's not. So money here and the entire DevOps industry is not necessarily the cause, it's the effect of the success of DevOps. So what is the cause? Now, this is what it's called the DevOps Infinity Cycle. And it basically covers the entire life cycle of software development. Now, if you've been in the industry long enough, you will recognize this as something very, very familiar. Anyone has like any flashbacks to what it looks like? This, right? This is another cycle, and this is a very, it looks a lot like that. So we also have plan and code and build and test, which is something that all the developers do. With the other half of release, deploy, operate, and monitor. It looks like someone had this idea, how about we take what developers do, and then we take what the ops do, and stick them together and say, hey, developers, this is all your responsibility now. You not only do this part, but yeah, go ahead and do this part as well, because, you know, DevOps. More proof. State of DevOps report. The most important kind of source of the state of DevOps in the world. Now, this is a screenshot from a very, very old one, I think, like maybe almost 10 years ago. And the reason why it's here, the numbers are completely different now, is what I want to show you here is what are the important metrics for people to measure DevOps. And you can see here how new work in cups and kind of on a blue background is here the first one, like the major thing. And it actually makes perfect sense because this is where the money is, right? When we engineers work on new work, this is very important, much more important than the other stuff, which is like whatever it is, the rework is, like unplanned work and rework and remediating issues, et cetera, right? So in customer support. So we want more new work and less everything else, which is fine. The real question is, how do DevOps people define what new work is? And for that, we read through the report and we find stuff like planned work. Planned work is the new work. Business projects and new features. And we're like, ah, that looks good. That makes sense. But then when we look at other type of work, it starts to be weird. Internal project, server migrations, software updates, and so on. And we go like, huh? And then changes, driven by feedback on completed work, perfect. And then unplanned work, support escalations and emergency outages. I mean, it's very nice, but it has really nothing to do with us, the developers. Our types of work are new features, which is writing code, refactoring, which is writing code, and fixing bugs, which is writing code. No unplanned outages or service escalations and all this kind of stuff. Again, we look at the DevOps report and we see that even the language is all about ops. It's not about dev in any way. So I think by now it's pretty clear that DevOps is an elaborated plot of ops people to make us, the developers, work harder, right? All right. But what is our work of the developers. There are many definitions, and one of them is this software craftsmanship. It has a lot of issues, especially because of the personalities of people who wrote it, and like it's a one big ball of mess. But the concepts and the message is right. And as developers, you will probably agree, again, with the message of this manifest. We want well-crafted software, we want steadily add value, we want community of professionals, and we want productive partnerships. All those are very correct words. And if we kind of look at it real good and break it down, we can come up with a list of software craft person definition of done. What is work for developers, right? So we got what they want, right? We understood the requirements. And our code is clear, and our code is easy to deploy. We are not enemies of the ops people. We want them to have a breeze when deploying our software. Our software has to be very easy to deploy, and non-functional requirements met, like stuff like security and performance and everything else. And then we didn't incur new technical debt. Maybe we even get rid of some old one. Our tests are passing. The people who are in charge for quality are happy with our quality. And our team lead, who is kind of the representative of the organization, is happy with what we are doing. And the product owner, which is the representative of the customer, is happy as well. This is kind of what we as developers want to happen when we want to say, OK, this feature is done. Agreed? Make sense? Great. Now, you remember this, right? It was like about the friction between developers and testers. Do anyone think that this is true? Yeah, well, a couple of people, I guess. But I would say it's something probably more on like inter-organizational dynamics, because as an industry, I think we stepped past that. None of us, or most of us, don't see testers as enemies of developers. It's the other way around. We understand that they want to help us. We are on the same side. They want to make sure that we have less bugs, so they help us and we listen to them. There are pricks, right, that just like want to get on our nerves. But generally, they are there to help us and they want to help because quality is important for us. That we already did that. And if the quality is important to us, we need to make sure that this quality is met. But what is quality? I would claim that quality is something that changes. Let's go back in time. This is the website of my bank in 2007. Not that long ago, but still pretty long time ago. By then, it was pretty... It was useful, kind of, sort of, checking balance. But other than that, it was pretty useless. If I wanted to do something significant, I would go to my branch. And you can see here, there are news and announcements. And if suddenly there was like a news like, hey, we need 12 hours of maintenance for our website to ensure quality, we would just shrug and say, OK, if that's like 12 hours that I cannot use my bank website, which is pretty useless anyway, I won't just use it, and it's fine. And obviously, nowadays, our perception of quality is completely different, and none of us would tolerate that. I, for one, changed my bank based on which phone app was more convenient. And this is something that, again, 20 years ago, was not even something to consider. Right? And another problem is that code quality is not enough, because we live in the time of explosion of data. And this is a survey done by Seagate, which obviously do storage, so they might be biased and have some interest and have those numbers inflated or what's not. But even if we like kind of be very, very careful about those numbers, I mean, 275 zettabytes is a lot. What is big data for us now? Which units? When you think about big data, what will be? petabyte, right? Petabyte is a lot, right? Now, zettabyte is not the next one. I forget what's the name of the next one after petabyte. Exabyte. So zettabyte is after exabyte. This is really a lot of data. And what it means is that even the smaller companies now go into the area in which it's absolutely impossible, or maybe possible, but definitely not feasible, creating staging environments which will represent production environments close enough to be sure that what we are testing is exactly what is going to run in production based on data alone. It's just too expensive. Which means that a stage server as we knew and loved it is dead. If we cannot reproduce our production environment on our staging server doesn't make any sense. It was nice when it lasted, no more. Now, what do we do if we don't have to stay the staging server to test? What do? We obviously test in production. And there is an entire industry of testing in production. And what I love about them is how crystal clear what they are doing is by looking at their terminology. It's called canary deployment. And you know the story about canary? It's the bird that they let go into the coal mines to see if there are, if there is too much of the CO2 gas. And the way they knew if its canary died. Right, so canary deployment that is deployed toward you means that you are the canary, and if something is wrong, you're probably going to die, but it's good for them because they will know. Now, but my favorite is, where is it? I need to find it. It's somewhere here. Blessed red ears. Blessed red ears is beautiful. It means we're going to throw something in production. It is going to blow up for sure. The only thing that we're going to do is try to minimize the blast radius. So yeah, we're going to test in production, and people are going to suffer. But if, for us the developers, production matters, it means that quality matters. It means that the only place we can see how many people were casualties over blast radius is in production. So it means that we have to be there when our software goes to production, and that means we need to be on call because we do a rollout at 3 a.m. in the morning, and then, you know, all the hell broke loose because blast radius. We need to be there. This is our code. This is our quality. This is our responsibility. So now we have a new item in our software craft person definition of done, which is it is DevOps ready. Now, what does it mean, DevOps ready software? Also sometimes called cloud native. It's not exactly the same, but it's pretty close. It means that we know how our software is deployed in a very clear deployment plan, and our build is very stable and very fast, because, you know, you use Gradle, obviously. And then our code is as stateless as possible because state is messy when we do deployments, upgrades, and downgrades. And then our code starts fast and dies fast because we might need to restart a couple of times because, you know, everything is in ruins and we need to redeploy and this kind of stuff. Observability, we actually know that we have a problem sooner than people start complaining on Twitter. We use feature flags so we can just turn off one of the parts of the website that doesn't work. Backwards and forwards compatible. We have microservices. We might end up in downgrading a part of our software when other software is on a further version. So forward compatible is a big deal. Event streaming, et cetera, et cetera. So basically, this is what it means to have our software DevOps ready. Now, as we mentioned, DevOps has been around for more than 10 years now, almost 15, and developers still aren't excited about DevOps, and I think our experiment just proved it, right? You're all like, ugh. But we just said we have to be there, right? DevOps is not an option anymore because we care about what we are doing. We need to build software which is cloud native and DevOps ready. So how do we go from this, go and do DevOps, to actually something which is better? Now, funny thing about this GIF. There are tons of GIFs that start with smiling and then go to crying. I didn't find a single one that does the opposite. I had to like reverse it in like video editing software. It's, I don't know why, it says something about us as a whole. All right, but we do try to go from this to this. How do we do that? So let's look again at what DevOps is. Back in the day, 15 years ago, I saw a lot of Venn diagrams that look like this. DevOps is something in the middle between Dev, Ops, and QA. And then, like, in the middle, there is DevOps. This diagram is completely useless because what does it mean? Is it, like, people who know everything about Devs and Ops and QA? Or what does it mean? This is an absolutely useless diagram. So instead, how about DevOps is an intersection between people, process, and tools. Now, this is also start to make more sense because this is where developers work with ops and QA and security and product and everybody else as people. And then there is a process, which is actually DevOps, of how everybody work together. And then there are tools that make this process actually work. Right? So we're talking about productive. People collaborate inside a productive process by using productive tools. This is all start to make more sense. We know how the productive process is called. It's called empowered teams. The idea is that you take those people from different teams, your developers, your ops people, your QA people, your security, your product, your whoever, put them together and make them create, produce, and release software. This is DevOps. This is the process. Well, tools, I mean, to a point, we have productive tools. One could argue, but we kind of get it figured out. What about productive people? What make people productive? There is no answer in the DevOps theory to this question, and this is why I want to mention before I wrap up another view on the same triangle of things. That would be something that solves the pain like builds and tests are slow. This kind of topic is not answered in your classic DevOps theory because DevOps is very much focused on quality in production. We spoke about it. How we make this canary alive. How we minimize the blast radius. As a developer, your build slow, who cares? The end quality is what matters. But for us, the developers, is obviously painful. Like, what else is here? Too much time spent on build and test. We spoke about it. Insufficient observability of analytics of my local build and test. Again, we have great observability now for our production environments. We spoke about it. How about observability for our local environments? So what brings it all together is developer productivity engineering. Developer productivity engineering is a discipline that concentrates on productive people. Tenets like foster faster feedback. That's your waiting less on your builds and tests. Stuff like eliminate toil, but for developers, how the developers are more productive. Collaborate through effective tooling. Instead of, hey, something is wrong in my environment, here's a link on the exact line in the build that fails. Stuff like prioritize automation and eliminate bottlenecks. This is very DevOpsy, but again, for your local environments and for developers. observability and proactive improvement, again, right from DevOps, but instead of only for production, also for your local environments. Dedicated organizational mindset that think about all that, and outcomes over output. If you ever try to find a reason for a failure in the log of a build tool, you know exactly what I'm talking about, right? Outcomes is, hey, this is why it failed, and not like, here is 20 screens of stack trace. Good luck in finding what happened. So just to summarize, is DevOps is against developers? Well, yes, we figured it out. The DevOps started as mainly solving ops concerns by making processes and ops tools more productive. This is how it started. But nowadays, it's much more than that, including developer productivity engineering, which makes developers more productive as well. So this is how we bring the developers to get excited about DevOps, but making them as productive as your production systems. And with that, thank you very much. You can learn more and try it today. Thank you. You can make your build faster by taking the speed challenge, and you can spread the word about developer productivity engineering and DevOps. You can read the DP handbook and watch the DP summit videos and all that if you go to, where is it? Here, speaking.jbaruch, seeing all the links, the video, the slides, but also obviously tweeting about this excellent event and this particularly good talk on this event. Thank you very much. Any time for questions? Not at all. What's going on? I have no idea.
I think we are at time for questions. Are you going to be around?
I am around.
Around through the evening. So hold those questions. Fine, Baruch. You
have one question. One question. Let's make it fun. One question.
We're already over time. We're just standing.
Okay, that people are much more time conscious than I am. Okay, so yeah, find me and let's chat. I will give you even more conspiracy theories of where this comes from. Thank you very much.